know it was the blood. I know it was the blood. Oh, I know it was the blood for me. One day when I was lost, that's all right, he died upon the cross. And I know it was the blood for me. Let's do that again now.
Baptist, I'm Deacon Hunter of Victory Baptist Church. To all the viewers, Heavenly Father, I'll be doing devotion this morning. I'll be reading from Psalms 27, verses 1 through 4, and then after that, I'll have a prayer. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though an host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though wars thou should arise against me, in this will I be confident. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, and to inquire in his temple. Let us bow our heads this morning. O Heavenly Father, we come into you this morning in the humblest way we know how. First, Lord, thanking you for this day that you have set upon us. But, oh Lord, we can't forget to ask for your forgiveness for all our sins and wrongdoings that we have done. Lord, lift us up, guide us, and continue to strengthen us in the time we need. Oh, Heavenly Father, we ask you this morning that you bless the sick and the shut in. Oh, Lord, touch the doctors, Heavenly Father. Give them confidence of some things that they run into that are seen and unseen. Then, Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless our church, the Victory Family, Heavenly Father. Not only the Victory Family, but all the churches that are open in your name's sake. Heavenly Father, as we go to a rebuilding situation, just lift us up, Heavenly Father. Guide us as we prepare to rebuild, Heavenly Father. Oh, Heavenly Father, we ask that you bless the pastor. Guide and strengthen him, Heavenly Father. He's the leader. Heavenly Father, let him give him the strength that he needs to endure, Heavenly Father, as he go on this tedious journey with us. Then, Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless the bereaved all over the world. Touch them in a special way, Lord. Comfort them. Keep them in your care, Lord. Then, Heavenly Father, we can't forget the homeless that are out there on the streets, Lord. Just touch them in a special way. Let them know that you're still there for us, Heavenly Father. Then, Heavenly Father, we ask you a blessing upon this world, Heavenly Father, for we're going through terrible times. But we know, Heavenly Father, you can fix it. Then, Heavenly Father, as we go into that room and we say our last prayer, we read our last scripture, Lord, we ask that you comfort us, Heavenly Father, and we receive in your holy name. Amen.
One more day. One
sweet Lord, sweet chariot, come before to carry me home. Sweet Lord, sweet chariot.
Thank you. Good morning, friends and Victory Church members and supporters and encouragers. It's a blessing to be with you one more time, the first Sunday in the month of February. This is known as Black History Week. Probably get a chance to emphasize something about Black history during this month. I would like to call your attention to Hebrews, the 10th chapter, somewhere around the 24th verse. And it reads as follows: "And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together or fellowshipping together, as some are in the habit of doing." Some people are doing it. They've been doing it, not meeting together. "But encouraging one another, and all the more as ye see the day approaching." If you don't mind, we're going to talk with you for a few minutes from the subject, Be Encouraged. Does anyone need to be encouraged today? Be encouraged. Be encouraged in the Lord. Be encouraged in the faith. Be encouraged in and of yourself. Words and deeds that are designed to motivate you to do that which is good and has substance, and that has motivational content to induce you to carry on. The writer of this passage, we don't know. Some say Paul, some say Apollos. There's other names that have come up on screen of who wrote Hebrews. The book of Hebrew, we don't know, but we know this, that a person was very familiar with the Hebrew culture, and the recipients also knew the Old Testament writings and were familiar somewhat to a degree with the presence, the power, and the significance, and the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ being the greater sacrifice, or one of the intents of the writer, so much, it's a superfluous amount of imagery about sacrifice. In the Old Testament, the idea of sacrifice was to cover the sins. But in the New Testament, we have Jesus Christ, the Son of God, that essentially washes away the sins of the world through his blood, which is essential to salvation. So the Old Testament teachings are very strong on sacrifice of animals, this type of thing, whereas the New Testament teaches the supreme sacrifice of Jesus on the cross of Calvary, dying for our sins. God loved his son Jesus so much that he sent him to die in our stead, in our place. So it's about Jesus that the New Testament teaches. And so we thank God for the blood of Jesus. Sacrifices were not unique to the Hebrews, because it's been noted by many scholars that in Africa, in ancient Africa, that a major part of worship was the sacrifice of animals according to one's ability. And sacrifice had become a major part of a significant amount of society. It seems that people knew that something needed to be done about their state, their religious state, their emotional state. People were not so sure that just by their presence in daily living, that it was enough to be able to see and to feel, to approach a higher being, as in the New Testament, it would be the presence of God. Sin covered by the blood of Jesus, sin being washed away by the blood of Jesus. So I should say in correction that the Old Testament, the blood symbolically covered the sins, but in the New Testament, the blood of Jesus is our source. The Hebrew community, or the local community, had problems with the Christian Hebrews and vice versa. For the local community was very strong on sacrifice of animals. The animals would be sacrificed, and that would cover the sins, or perhaps take the sins away. But the New Testament teachings were different than the Old Testament teachings. It in that sense, it fulfilled the law. The supreme sacrifice would be Jesus Christ, our Lord. And there were those who still adhere to the teachings of their time, of their historical time, whereas the teachings of Jesus Christ as the supreme sacrifice for our sins would be more current. So you had the, what some people called obsolete, and you had the new thought that would be Jesus Christ, the center of our lives, and the blood of Jesus, which would put us in a place of forgiveness for our present, past, and future sins. Verse 24 in our NIV Bible, it says, "And let us consider how we spur one another on towards love." Let us consider how we exhort one another on toward love in good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Consider, behold, observe, take deep notice of the times in which we live in, those who are surround us and to spur one another towards love and good deeds. So apparently there was a shortage of the manifestation or the uniqueness or the sincerity of love one towards another. It appears that people that were knowledgeable and had accepted Jesus Christ, the blood of Jesus, perhaps they did not, were not that super concerned about those who were falling by the way. I think that's very important for us to realize that we can't just go based on what we have, but we have, and those who are strong have a duty to help the weak. Those who are weak in their religious standing, they're starting to slip and fall or not to accept the word. We need to continue to push them as well as ourselves to where God would want us to be through the blood of Jesus. We should take deep notice of what's going on around us within our congregations and our community. Consider, behold. And then we should be concerned here, says, exhort or spur one another on toward love and good deeds. We must have the love. We must spur one another to have and to show that love within with good deeds. We want to have love and affection and goodwill towards our brothers and sisters. Verse 25 says, not giving up meeting together. Let us consider how we may spur one another toward love and good deeds. If you want to know a sick church, a church that's not healthy, it's one that does not have and encourage love of one another and treating people rightly. So it was important that we show this love, affection, and goodwill towards one another and those who are weak, to help them to grow, to glow and grow in grace. Now, in order for this to happen within an environment where there were differing opinions and pressures and mistreatment of those who had one view of religion and religious practices and those who had another view of religious practices, it wasn't those who were strong in the faith. They were the ones that understood the message of the supreme sacrifice. While there were others that did not care for the way that they would, or their standing, so therefore it was like placing them on defense or attack. But we were to, as Christians, to love one another and to encourage each other and to enlighten each other and not attack one another. But we are to encourage one another. And that comes by way of our association with one another. The assembly or the fellowship, this is where this can take place. The scripture says, not giving up meeting together, whether that's by division or people that have just become fragmented in their beliefs or their position. They have become uninterested, lukewarm. They've failed. Some other things have taken the place of the fellowship of one another, where they can encourage each other in Jesus. When we remove ourselves from the fellowship, then we become at risk for something to fill that void. And it's easy to become disassociated with one another. Think how easy it is for you not to attend church or have some type of religious activity during the week, and sooner than later, something else is going to take its place. That was one of the worries about COVID, people becoming too lackadaisical, where when the time come when we could get together, that they've already been oriented and not fellowshipping. So we thank God that we have YouTube. We thank God we have Zoom. We have Bible studies throughout the week where people can encourage one another. It's very important on this Christian journey to be in assembly and come together. But we need to use that time to encourage ourselves, to encourage each other. It can become habitual of being remote from the congregation. And I've seen it, I've experienced through Victory Baptist Church, people, you know, that you would see on a regular basis or that you would hear from, have just removed themselves from the fellowship. You don't know if they went someplace else or whatever the problem is, but they haven't shared it with you. Deacons may call and they will say, "Well, you know, I'm still with you," but there's no evidence of them being with us. And the day is approaching, so we should be, you know, readying ourselves and developing ourselves in such a way that we are ready when the day is approaching. Usually when that's used in scripture is when the Lord will return. It is no news, again, and those who are listening to me know. And it's so sad. I've seen people near and far that were regular fellowshippers. They were happy to go to church, to see one another. They were happy to do that. And then something happened. Maybe someone didn't do what they thought they should do, or some deacon didn't do what they were thought to do, or a deaconess or the preacher, and people complaining, and their own lives are disrupted, and they take it and spill this off onto you. Now you are already in a state of uninvolvement, and it doesn't take much negativism that's anti-encouragement, y'all don't hear what I'm saying, to get you off course. And Christians need to be aware and sensitive of that. Is some experiences you might have in your church or with your church or someone at the church, you must be careful not to disencourage someone along the way by you sharing your troubles in that sense with them. If you must call someone or visit someone, speak words of kindness and of encouragement. That's the purpose of the church. If you feel abused or attacked, a strong Christian would seek to make things better and not to make it worse. But we for some reason in our mindset, not everybody, but some in our mindset, we just don't like misery. Put your finger on that. We're kind of anti-encouragement. We're just not concerned about ourselves being miserable. Do you hear what I'm saying? Now you might be as miserable as you can be. Family, whatever the problem is, miserable. Your life, your job, miserable. Your church, miserable. But a Christian, it shouldn't be that bad for a Christian, but a Christian who's just not content with themselves being miserable is they get a solace and comfort out of making others miserable. So when they say misery loves company, don't let people, my brothers and sisters, play your life as a dump truck. That's not our mission. Book of Hebrews, whoever the writer was, says that we should come together to encourage each other in the Lord, or whatever our circumstances. And let me say this, if there's something that is presented to you and you don't know what to say, then it's best not to say anything, but say, I will pray for you. Because we don't have all the answers, but we can have an ear of concern. So these Christians and the Hebrews that are being persecuted, those who are a little bit stronger, encourage them in faith and in deeds in their life that they may be able to grow closer to God. They may grow and glow in the faith. Encourage one another. Encourage your brothers and sisters. I've experienced during this time of crisis that Victory Baptist Church has gone through, fire and all the other experiences that we've had. Thank God we've come this far. Thank you for coming this far. But people have, naysayers have used this, the crisis to draw people away from Christ. And they may not know that that's what they're doing, but if we can't speak kind words and encouragement and give a positive report and show our faith, then we're anti-Christian behavior. And so any of us from the pulpit to the pew that has not been a positive source to the weak and to the strong, then we should repent to God that he may forgive us and turn from our wicked ways, our wicked ways, because it's not biblical. Encourage one another. Those who are weak in faith, and even those who are strong, need encouragement. If you're unemployed or you're underemployed, you need encouragement. If your family is toxic, and there's no peace. The love that should be in your immediate family, animosity and hate has taken the place of love. You need encouragement. If your loved one is gone, God has come and taken them away, and they've left a void at the table where they would sit during the holidays, and your heart is heavy, you need encouragement. If Arthur has robbed you of your mobility and moving from one place to another is painful, and your joints have inflammation, so it's hard to be mobile and to get around from place to place, but you're still trying. You need encouragement. If your family is split in divorce, and you're a child, you want to blame yourself. You don't know why mommy and daddy are no longer together. And you miss that parent that removed himself from the home. You need encouragement. If mommy or daddy died, someone close to you has died, and you felt they've left you all alone, and you don't know which way to turn, somebody help me now. You need what? Encouragement. If you're in an abusive relationship, you are afraid to remain, you are afraid to leave, and you don't know which way to go, a child of God should be able to give you some encouragement in the Lord. Thank God that we have Christian brothers and sisters. I thank him every day for those who talk, who pause and take time out and say, Pastor, be encouraged. We know that you're going through a difficult time trying to lead your people and to coordinate and to encourage people to continue on, remain with the church, remain with the Lord. Yes, it's difficult. Sometimes you may stay awake sometimes at night. Those words are encouragement go a long way, because on the other side of the encouragement, you have the naysayers, those who just want to tear you down. Everything you do is not good enough. But thanks be to God, you have those folk who believe in encouragement that will give you the strength and the courage to carry on to see what the Lord has in store. If you are having challenges in school, or challenges with your friends, you don't know what to do, someone needs to encourage you along the way. I'm so glad that we have, that God has blessed us with those in our lives that have the best motive for us, who desire to just keep us in the mix no matter what the trial and tribulation. But this also comes through our fellowshipping one way or the other with each other. You're going through something right now. It's not a time to isolate yourself, but to embrace those who genuinely care about you and give you the wisdom to know the difference. Sometimes in life it gets rough, but God finds you a secret closet. You know, we're not always able to get the encouragement of others because sometimes they have troubles too. So sometimes you just have to encourage yourself. Sometimes you have to speak victory during the test. No matter how you feel, just if you consider and trust in the word, God is able, if it's in his divine will, to heal. Speak over yourself and encourage yourself in the Lord. Is there anyone out there that needs encouragement? Why don't you just wave your hand at the screen and say, Lord, I need encouragement to walk this walk, to talk this talk. I need encouragement to make it through this crisis in my life. No matter how you feel, speak the word, and God is able to heal. Encourage yourself in the Lord. God bless you, and may keep you in his care. Father God, we come now. It's communion time. We will pause and give those who have their communion cups an opportunity to get the cup and the bread, and we will take communion together. So we're going to pause, give you a minute or so to get your cup and the fruit of the vine, and then we will take together the Lord's Supper. Is everybody ready? Anybody know? On the night our Jesus, our Lord Jesus Christ, was present with the disciple in the upper room, he instituted this ordinance to those who were with him. And he took the bread and told his disciples that this bread represents my body that is given for you. So he took the bread and told them, each of you eat of this bread. And then he took the fruit of the vine, made sure that everyone had, there was enough for everyone, and told them after he ordained them to eat the bread, that this fruit of the vine is representative of my blood, which will be shared for you. As oft as you do this, as oft as you drink, I want you to think of the Lord until he returns. This serves as a memorial. There's no specifics on how many times a week or a month or a day. He said, whenever you take this bread and wine, the bread representative of my flesh, the wine or grape juice of my blood, do it in remembrance of me. He said, all of you drink of it. After they took the bread and drank the drink, they sang a song. Went to Mount Olive. May God bless you, and may he keep you in his care. This is Pastor Edward Jenkins of Victory Baptist Church. We look forward to seeing you next Sunday. Same place, same time in the Lord. God bless you, and may he keep you in his care. Amen. Amen.
Pressure is on.